On Sunday, we're going to celebrate Chag HaShavuot, Sunday and Monday. The first day of Shavuot, the Torah reading is chapter 20 of Parashat Yitro, when we read about what people usually translate as the Ten Commandments. But this translation is incorrect. The word is Ten Commandments, because the Torah never calls them Aser HaMitzvot or Aseret HaHukim. It is called Aseret HaDevarim, the 10 concepts, or the 10 issues, 10 matters. There are many different interpretations to the Aseret HaDevarim, which I remember. Aseret HaDevarim, yes, in Bet Hanan. It's Aseret HaDevarim. In the book of Devarim, it is mentioned. I'll use the word 10 commandments just for convenience when we're talking, but I want to show that they're not all commandments, and more you could refer to them really as concepts or teachings. And if you count them as mitzvot, how many commandments are there in this set? It's actually 8 and not 10, because the first one and the last one are not part of the commandments. The commentators struggled with some of the commandments that we have here. But most significantly with the last one, which is Lo Tahmod, you shall not covet, because how can you command someone not to covet? It's an emotion. But when we look at the second part of the Ten Commandments, the last five, let's go one by one with those five, because they are conceived as the prohibitions. They're perceived as the prohibitions. Lo Tirtzach, Lo Tinaf, Lo Tignov, Lo Ta'aneh Bere'acha Et Shaker, לא תחמוד בית רעיך. לא תחמוד את רעיך ועבדו ועמתו, שורו וחמורו וכל אשר לרעיך. לא תרצח, you shall not kill, you shall not murder. לא תנאף, you shall not commit adultery. לא תגנוב, you shall not steal. לא תענה ברעך את שקר, you shall not testify false testimony, you shall not bear false witness. לא תחמוד בית רעיך, you shall not covet the house of the other, his wife, his servant, his maidservant, his ox, his donkey, or anything which belongs to him. So now, on the commandment of Lo Tignov, you shall not steal, Rashi makes the following commentary, which is based on the Gemara in Midrash Halacha. Lo Tignov, begonev nefashot hakatuv medaber. So when the Torah says you shall not steal, it does not speak of money, but rather about kidnapping. Why? אמרת דבר הלמד מעניינו. מה לא תרצח, לא תנאף, מדבר בדבר שחיו עליהם מיתת בדין. He says, you have to compare it to the whole discussion. We see it in context. The previous two commandments were, you shall not commit adultery, you shall not murder. Those two carry the death punishment. Theft, or any monetary offense, does not carry the capital punishment in Jewish law. So it must be something that is a capital offense. And that is kidnapping, because the Torah says later on, Gonev ish u'mcharo, v'nimtza b'yado mot yumat. One who kidnaps a person deserves the death penalty. So that's the conclusion of the Gemara. However, it doesn't work with the simple meaning of the text. First of all, because when you say Lo Tignov, to steal without any qualifications means stealing of property and not kidnapping. The one exception in the Torah where there's a commandment, it says Gonev Ishum Chao, it says he who steals a person. So you have to specify. If the Torah would speak about here stealing or kidnapping a person, she said Lo Tignov Ish. Just Lo Tignov means any theft. The other problem is that there are five prohibitions in the second part of the Ten Commandments. Murder, adultery, theft, false witness, and coveting. There's no way that coveting will carry the death punishment. To covet, to desire that which belongs to other, how can it be punished with death? There's no way for that to happen. Even according to those rabbis who try to tie it into a physical action, because the commentators struggled with it, they said to just covet, it's to desire something which doesn't belong to me, is an emotion, right? It's in your heart. You see a nice car, a nice house, or someone who's very wise or beautiful or powerful, and you say, I want to be like that person, I want to have what that person has, that's an emotion. How can you control that?
You cannot prove it.
The only the Torah mentions in other places things that have to do with emotions, like lo tisna et achicha bilvavecha, you shall not harbor hatred towards your brother in your heart. Recognizing that to tell you not to hate is difficult, but at least don't harbor hatred in your heart. Be open about what you feel. Ve'ahavta le'racha kamocha, love others is a commandment, but it's something that you could nurture and you could develop within yourself. Does it mean the same here? That's the question. Some rabbis said that coveting is only a prohibition when it becomes an action. Meaning that if, for example, you covet, you desire the house of your neighbor, and you buy him out, you don't steal it, God forbid. No. You go and you say, I want to buy your house. He says, I don't want to sell. So how much do you want for it? I'll give you double, or I'll give you 25% more. And I know of cases like that. People who love their house but could not refuse the offer that was given to them. So some commentators say this is lo tahmod. This is when you force someone to sell you that which belongs to him. It's a prohibition, which is also problematic, because at the end of the day, it's the decision of the seller. The Torah always speaks about the responsibility of a human being, that we are responsible for our actions. If the other one doesn't want to sell, he doesn't have to sell. It is his choice to take money over possessions. And if he is in a difficult stage in life and he needs the money, maybe it was helpful for him. Cannot say that the other one was a transgressor because he offered him money. It's hard to say that. So I want to look at it from a different perspective. Also, address the way that people usually see the Ten Commandments divided into two units of five concepts or five commandments each. One is dealing with issues that are between us and God, Ben Adam LaMakom, and the other half between us and fellow human beings, which is Ben Adam LaHavero. The problem with that division is that in the first set we have the fifth commandment, the fifth concept is Kabed et avicha ve'et imecha lema'an ya'arichun yamecha ala adama asher Hashem Elocha noten lach. Honor your father and mother so you'll have long life on land that Hashem is giving to you. So what is Kabed avicha ve'et imecha? Is it between us and God or between us and other human beings? Some commentators wanted to say, to solve that problem, they say this is the link, this is the bridge between God-directed commandments and human-directed commandments, because the reason the Torah has to command us to honor our parents is that some people say that, or some people argue, that they don't have to honor their parents, they don't have to show gratitude to their parents, because whatever their parents did for them was natural. So my parents had to take care of me because they brought me into the world, and because they have the instinct of taking care of their descendants. So whatever they did, they had to do. I don't have to be grateful for that.
Well, because they also say, you know, I didn't ask to be brought into
right, the world. Right, people say that. I didn't ask you to, you know, you chose to have me, right? And people associated with the new generation. But it has always existed. It has always existed. Maybe now it's more outspoken than it was before. But we have that children show disrespect to their parents because they feel that they whatever their parents did for them, they were obligated to do, and they feel entitled to it. So the lack of gratitude would eventually spill over and will be interpreted as, will be also displayed as ingratitude towards God. Because God is the creator. Shutav ma'aseh bereshit. We say that God himself participates in the creation of humans, and we are participating in the act of creation. So there will be those who say, God must take care of us because he created us. I don't have to be grateful to God. So this is the argument that says that learning to be grateful is something that works both towards God and towards other human beings. It's a very interesting moral lesson. I want to look at it, I said, from a different point of view. The first set, the first five, I think, show us the gift that every human being has in his life. And it's here specifically the Jewish people, but eventually we know that it's going to be extended to the whole world, because before the Ten Commandments, before this whole Ma'amad HaSinai, the event at Mount Sinai, Hashem tells Moshe, Ve'atem tiyuli mamlechet kohanim ve'goy kadosh, you will be unto me a kingdom of kohanim and a sacred nation, goy kadosh, or a distinguished nation. So mamlechet kohanim, what is the idea of a kingdom of kohanim? The role of the kohen at the time of the temple was to not only to serve in the temple, because then you guys would do 2 weeks or 3 weeks a year, right? It was not a full-time job, because there were many kohanim and they worked in shifts in the temple. What did they do the rest of the year? That is revealed by the Navi Malachi, ki siftei kohen yishmeru da'at v'torah yivakshu mipiyu ki malach Adonai tzevaotu. He says the lips of the kohen are the guardians of knowledge, and people will seek Torah from him, for he is the messenger of God. Ki malach Hashem Tzevaot, he is the messenger of God. So the Kohen's role was to teach. So the few weeks that they spent in the temple, the Kohanim were elevated spiritually, were sort of, they charged their batteries, and then the rest of the year they would go around the land of Israel, teach people, instruct them, and get them on track. So they're like spiritual trainers. So the Torah says, you, Am Yisrael, as a nation, you will become the kingdom of Kohanim, meaning that your role will be to share this knowledge with the whole world. So the Kohen inspires and shares knowledge with Am Yisrael. Now Am Yisrael becomes a Kohen to the nations. So the end goal is that this will be shared with the whole world. And indeed, through Christianity and Islam, and in other means, the Tanakh, the Torah, the verses of the Torah have been translated to multiple languages. Last time I checked, it was 800. Probably now it's 1,000 languages that the Tanakh has been translated into, and the ideas permeated the whole world. So, what Hashem starts talking to Bnei Israel, he says, "Anochi Adonai Elohecha." This is the first dibir. It's not a commandment. When Hashem says, I am God, your God, who took you out of Egypt, of the house of bondage, it's a statement. It's a statement. Some count it as a mitzvah, the mitzvah to believe in God who took us out of Egypt. But as it is, it's a statement. That is also the reason that when we read the Torah in public, there's a different division of the psukim. It's called Ta'am Elyon. There are two ways to write the trope, the Ta'amim, of the Ten Commandments. One, as it is printed in the Sidur, is divided into verses. So the longer commandments, or Dibrot, or Devarim, are divided into two or three verses, and the smaller ones are lumped into one pasuk, like Lo Tirtzach, Lo Tina'af, Lo Tignov, Lo Ta'aneh Be'erachat Shekhar, all one pasuk. In the Ta'am Elyon, when we read it in the public, each diber is one pasuk, is one. So the Ta'amim have to change, because you have to spread it over a longer text, and that's why people associate also with more elaborate music, because the Hazanim or the readers use that to cantillate and to. So, for example, right. So, for example, the first diber, right, is divided here in the ta'am, in the ta'am tahton, the regular ta'amim, into you know, it says 1, 2, 3, 4, 5 psukim, and it's five. Only the first diber is five psukim, and it goes like this: Anochi Adonai Elohecha. Asher otzeticha me'eretz Mitzrayim mibet avadim. So pasuk lo yelecha. Is it the same pasuk? Lo yelecha. Sorry, I'm doing the alion. Lo yelecha Elohim acherim al panayim. Another pasuk. Lo ta'aseh lecha fesen v'chol temuna אשר בשמיים, עם הענווה אשר בארץ, מתחת הענווה אשר במים, מתחת לארץ. So this is the way you read the regular reading. The Tam Elyon has to take this pasuk, and it's here. It will be like, Anochi Adonai Elohecha Asher Hoceticha Me'eretz Mitzrayim Mibet Avadim Lo Yelecha Elohim Acherim Al Panai Lo Ta'aseh Lecha Fesel V'chol Temuna Asher Bashamayim Mimal V'asher Ba'al Mitachat Asher Bamayim תחר לארץ, לא תשתחווה להם, ולא תעובדם, כי אנוכי, אדוני אלוהיך, אל קנה, etc.
That's
עליון. That's עליון. It's not even the end of the. It's much longer because you have the, okay, it's the way, we're divvying it a little bit, but it's important. The way the ta'amim are arranged in the Torah is that we have mafsikim, mesharatim, we have ta'amim, which are like stop signs. Then there are ta'amim, which are like a yield sign that you sort of stop, but you slide into the next. And then there are ones that are kesarim, or you know, you can't, like you chant when you sing them. So in a regular, most psukim, you'll have to have an atnah in the middle. Atnah means you rest. So in the middle of pasuk, you have that rest. This is like the comma that breaks the pasuk in two. Almost every pasuk in the Torah has an atnah in it, unless it's very, very short. If it's, there are some short psukim like 4 or 5 or yeah, six words, only Batam Elyon. So Lo Tignov, when you read it in public, it becomes one pasuk. So there's no atnah. It's only tarha, so pasuk. There's really no pasuk of two words. But when you say each diber gets its own pasuk, its own unit, then Lo Tirtzach, which is two words, becomes a pasuk. So you say Lo Tirtzach. And then lo tinaf lo, each one of the pasuk. But if you read it in the regular time, it would be lo tirzah, lo tinaf, lo tignov, lo taneh berach, right? Shaker, one stop. So when you read a longer pasuk, the longer the pasuk becomes, the more fragmented you have to create the ta'amim in order to lead to the end. So you will have to do paser gadol, talsa, azla geresh, ravia. Those are, this is said, that usually goes together and could fit 5-6 words. Anyway, when the Ta'am Elyon is read in public, like I said, each diber gets its own pasuk, right? Its own unit. And there are two different traditions on how to divide the Ten Commandments. One divides them into 10 units. The other one divides them, and that's what we read, into only 9. Because the first and the second are bundled together, because they're inseparable. To say, I am God, worship no other gods. So already there we see the sort of confusion regarding the nature of the commandment. So the first one is a statement. I am, and we'll have to probably continue the rest of the discussion tomorrow, because it would be long, but I'll just say in the gist of it. So Hashem says, I am Hashem who took you out of Egypt. What does it mean? It means that I gave you freedom. And that is the message of the Torah from the very beginning. With the creation of mankind, the Torah says, Ki betzelem Elohim bara et Adam, that man was created, not man, mankind, men and women, were created in the image of God. The idea of the image of God is that all humans are equal. And it's especially important that Torah says it when it speaks of the creation of men and women, because the first difference that comes out when we look at each other as human beings is the difference between men and women. So when Torah says men and women were created in the image of God, we understand that God has no physical image, because what would he be? A man or a woman? Neither. So, but yet both are in the image of God, meaning that which makes us divine or in the image of God is something deeper and not the physical shape or what is seen by the eye. So, and that gives us freedom, because when one human being considers himself to be superior to others, that's where we have slavery, that's where we have oppression, And the rabbi said it beautifully. Says Mipnema nivra adam yehidi shelo yomar adam lachaveru abba gadol meavicha. The reason that the creation of man is described as creating individuals, only one man, only one woman, and not a whole race at once. So no one could say my father is greater than your father, because we all come from the same stock, from the same person. So the first statement in the Aseret HaDevarim, the 10 statements or the 10 concepts, is you have freedom. As a human being, you're free. You should not be subjugated to anyone else. And that's why I took you out of Bet Avadim. That was the first lesson that we have as a nation, that we should not be bound by others. And as we'll see tomorrow, Be'ezrat Hashem, the first 5 of the 10 commandments are all about the gifts that Hashem give us, that we all have. It's the gift of spirituality, the gift of Shabbat, and the gift of family. That's the first half. Second half is about the things that belong to others. Torah says you should not take anything that belongs to others. Lo tirzach, life. Lo tinaf, adultery, relationships. Lo tignov, do not steal possessions. Lo ta'ne beracha, false testimony, the right to due process, the justice. Lo tahmod is a statement. Just like the first one is a statement, I took you out of Egypt, the last one is a statement. It's not you shall not covet, but rather you will not covet. Meaning, if you go through the process of educating yourself through those ten statements, gradually you will get to the point where you will not see the need to covet or to desire that which belongs to others, because you'll be satisfied with what you have. And that is the core message of the Torah, of just like v'avtala rechaka kamocha, when can you share generously and openly with others? When you realize that the joy of others is more important than you having and accumulating more possessions. And that leads eventually to tikkun olam, to a better world. Baruch Adonai le'olam, amen v'amen.